Ho ho ho! Welcome to the 2018 Christmas Mathologer video. In this edition I'd like to give you a present. A beautiful and easy to use precision tool for spotting irrational numbers. Interested? Let's start with something really simple. Is root 2 a rational number? That is it possible to write root 2 as a ratio of integers, as a fraction? Yes, yes, I can hear your thoughts. Is he kidding? Of course, even preschoolers know that root 2 is irrational. True, but now try this rooting number on your local preschooler. Rational or irrational? And how about this one? Or this one? Well, all these numbers look pretty damn irrational, right? But one of them isn't. This number here actually turns out to be equal to 1, which is very much not irrational. Surprised? So, given a rooty expression, how can we tell if it's truly, really irrational? My Christmas present to you is a mathologerization of the famous root theorems. These are the ultimate irrationality zappers, the master tools for deciding whether rooty numbers like the ones over there are rational or irrational. Many of you will have glimpsed these irrationality zappers in school, though probably with different packaging. A standard middle school maths game is to find the solutions to equations like this one there. Okay, so say you forgot your high-tech calculator and your life, or at least your test score, depends upon finding the solutions. What do you do? Well, since this is a school game, chances are the equation has been rigged to ensure there's a nice, simple integer solution. And if that is really the case, then there's a simple trick to narrow the hunt for such a solution. It turns out that if an equation like this has an integer solution, then that solution must divide the constant term 6. And so what are the factors of 6? Well, there is 1, 2, 3, what else? 6. Is that it? Not quite, since there are all the negatives as well. So if this equation has an integer solution, it's got to be one of these 8 numbers. So you cross your fingers, hope that your teacher or your mathologer has cooked up things correctly, and you start going through them. Well, let's start with 1. Let's see. Okay, so that didn't work out, and you can check that 2 also doesn't work, but we're lucky, 3 does. You can also check that none of the other integer candidates work, which means that 3 is the only integer solution to this equation. Great. Now, who among you learned this trick in school, and in what form? Let me know in the comments, including where in the world you're from. It will be interesting to see who gets served what at school. Okay, the official name for this trick is the integral root theorem. What does any of this have to do with irrational numbers? Well, if you actually state this trick as a proper theorem and not as the contrived guessing game presented in schools, then the integral root theorem runs like this. Given a polynomial equation with integer coefficients and, very important, leading coefficient 1 and, also very important, non-zero constant term, then any real solution of this equation is either an integer that divides the constant term, like that, or, and here it comes, or the solution is an irrational number. So the extra cool bit that is missing from the school trick is that any real solution that is not an integer must be an irrational number. No proper rational numbers like 1/2 or 17 over 13 can sneak in as a solution. Again, only integer or irrational solutions are possible. Let's now use the integral root theorem to pin down some irrational numbers, starting with our good old friend root 2. Root 2 is a solution to this quadratic equation here. Being approximately equal to 1.4, root 2 is definitely not an integer. Therefore, by the integral root theorem, it has to be irrational. How slick is that, huh? A different and important way to come to the same conclusion runs like this. The factors of the constant term minus 2 are, well, what are they? 1, minus 1, 2, and minus 2. And so by the integral root theorem, these 4 factors are the only possible integer solutions. But clearly, none of them is a solution, right? And that means that there are no rational solutions at all, and so every solution, including root 2, must be irrational. Exactly the same argument shows that the cube root of 2 is irrational, and in fact the same argument works for any root of 2. And for the nth root of any positive integer, that is not itself an nth power of an integer, of course. But I'm sure that for quite a few of you, the fact that these roots are irrational is old hat and not terribly exciting. So let's have a look at some more elaborate rooty combos like this one here. Rational or irrational? To find out, let's call this number, well, let's see. Let's call it something mysterious, something exotic like x. Squaring on both sides gets rid of the outer square root. Shuffling 2 to the right side gives this, and squaring again gets rid of the second root sign, okay? Now some quick algebra autopilot. Okay, what we've shown is that our root combo number is a solution of this polynomial equation. And now the integral root theorem is ready to pounce again. The only factors of the constant term are, well, 1 and minus 1, both of which are definitely not solutions of the equation. And so all real solutions of this equation, including our rooty combo number, must be irrational. How nifty is that? Next, how about this curious number here? I leave it as another challenge for you. Figure it out for yourself and let the rest of us know in the comments. And yes, it really does equal 3.14 dot dot dot. Now for the next step. Remember that the integral root theorem only applies to equations leading coefficient 1. But what if the leading coefficient is different from 1? Well, there's a super nifty generalization of the integral root theorem that takes care of this. It is called the rational root theorem. Okay. To turn the statement of the integral root theorem into the rational root theorem, we simply have to replace the integer dividing the constant term by a fraction u over v with u dividing the constant term, okay, like that, and v dividing the leading coefficient, like that. This means that in practice, and just as before, we can easily determine the very few candidates for rational solutions of an equation like this, right? And by doing so, we will have automatically proved that any other real solution must be irrational. Cool, huh? Here's another mini challenge for you to sort out in the comments. Remember, we also require that the constant term be different from zero. What happens and what do you do if the constant term is equal to zero? Well, it's pretty easy. Anyway, the real numbers solutions to polynomial equations like this are super important and have a special name. They're called the algebraic numbers. Numbers that are not algebraic, such as e and pi, are called transcendental numbers. So while the root theorems are fantastic tools for determining the irrationality of an algebraic number, they are of no use for transcendental numbers. But we also have an algebraic confession to make. It's definitely true that the root theorems are super powerful at showing which solutions to polynomial equations are irrational, but there's a cringy problem. Algebraic numbers are often presented in ways that don't automatically come with one of those special equations. And of course, we can't apply our root theorems unless we somehow produce the right polynomial equation. For example, it's true, but quite tricky to prove, that the rooty combo numbers, like the ones we pondered earlier, are algebraic. And for complicated rooty numbers, it's not at all obvious how you come up with such an equation. Just pick one of these guys over there and have a go at finding an equation for it. Take your time, I'll wait. No, I won't. However, all is not lost, even for very complicated rooty expressions. There are complex algorithms that, given the input of any rooty expression, will output a suitable polynomial equation. These algorithms have also been implemented as part of computer algebra systems. For example, in Mathematica or Wolfram Alpha, the relevant command is minimal polynomial. In fact, unleashing this command on a rooting number will spit out a special polynomial, an extra special polynomial, the so-called minimal polynomial. That is, a polynomial of lowest possible degree. But wait a minute. What is a polynomial equation with integer coefficients of least degree for a rational number? Think about it for a second. The answer is the simplest possible such equation is a linear equation. This one here. But that means that you can tell at a glance from the minimal polynomial whether a rooted expression is a rational number. And if so, what rational number? For example, on input of this expression here, Mathematica spits out this linear equation. And what does that mean? Well, obviously, that our number is rational and equal to 1. Surprising, but true. Here are two final, very challenging challenges for you. First, algebraically massage this rooting number into 1 by hand. Second, again by hand, try to find a polynomial equation that has this number as a root. Well, see what you come up with. That's all great. But if you're like Marty and me, you won't be very satisfied with this Mathematica black book solving the problem for us. Well, promise. Eventually, there will be another Mathologer video dedicated to proving that every real rooted expression is algebraic by showing how to construct its minimal polynomial. Very, very tricky stuff, but at the same time, extremely beautiful mathematics. Also on my to-do list is a video on the super surprising fact that even though all real rooted expressions are algebraic, not all algebraic numbers are rooty. For example, the one real root of this equation there is not rooty. Okay, time for the grand finale. Let me animate a super simple proof of the rational root theorem for you. Enjoy. As usual, I'll focus on a proof for a sufficiently general example. What must the fractional solution of this equation look like? Let's say u over v is a solution of the equation, and let's assume we've cancelled out such that u and v have no more common factors. Then what I'll do is show that u is a factor of the constant 3 and v is a factor of the leading coefficient 2. And that's all we need to do, right? Okay, 2 and 3 play a special role, so let's highlight them just a little bit. Okay, so u over v is a solution. There we go. Autopilot. Right. Let's shuffle the constant 3 to the right side of the equation, like that. To get rid of the fractions on the left, we'll multiply through by the largest denominator, v to the power of 6, like that. Again, just autopilot, right? That's what you all would do. Cancel, cancel, cancel. And now we have integers throughout, and all the terms on the left have the common factor u. Pull out the u in front. Now u divides the left side and so the right side as well. Think about it for a moment. You okay with that? Okay. However, we began by making sure that u and v have no common factor, and so u and v to the power of 6 also have no common factor. And so u must be a factor of 3. Easy, isn't it? And with a slight rearrangement, we can pin down v in exactly the same way. Let's back up one step. We'll now move everything to the right side except for the u to the power of 6 term. Like that. Now all the terms on the right have the common factor v. Pull the v out in the back. Now v divides the right side and therefore also the left side. And just like before, we can conclude that v divides 2. Easy peasy. What a fantastically simple proof for such a powerful theorem. Just a final footnote. The integral root theorem is a special case of the rational root theorem. In turn, the rational root theorem is a special case of a wonderful result called Gauss's lemma, named after the mathematical superstar Carl Friedrich Gauss. Further Googling is definitely recommended. I hope you enjoyed this mathematical Christmas present. Fröhliche Weihnachten!